Mr. President, after many months of discussion and debate, today we announced a bipartisan piece of legislation to reform our criminal justice system. I've been in the Senate long enough to realize that even the best ideas that don't have bipartisan support go nowhere. Nowhere. The good news is this is an issue that enjoys broad bipartisan support and actually represents the marriage of two distinct parts. But the more I think about it, the more it represents a continuum in terms of the way we punish people who violate our criminal laws and how we treat them when they're in prison and how we prepare them or not for a life of reentry into civil society. But it is an example, even in the polarized political environment that our country represents today, an opportunity to demonstrate that when enough people identify a problem and work together, we can actually come up with viable solutions. In a previous life, I served 13 years as a state district court judge and then as attorney general. And I've had an opportunity to witness some of the strengths and the weaknesses of our justice system firsthand. And though we've made some significant progress in reducing crime across the country, and by the way, Mr. President, that ought to be the litmus test, the crime rate. If the crime rate's going down, to me it indicates we're doing something right. If the crime rate goes up, that's pretty much a litmus test that we're doing something wrong. But the truth is our criminal justice system has been plagued with inefficiencies and overcrowding and failures that are ultimately detrimental to public safety. We spend too much of our criminal justice resources locking up low-level nonviolent offenders and not enough targeting the most dangerous and violent criminals. The good news is a number of states, including Texas, have seen the need and have implemented statewide criminal justice reforms with positive results. And you know, the longer I'm here, the more things occur to me about how we do business here. But the idea that we can somehow initiate reforms at the national level for 320 million people and then cram them down on a big and diverse country like the United States is really, it's pretty ludicrous. And actually, the federal government is rarely competent to do that sort of thing. And we saw this with the health care reforms, which have resulted in prices actually going up, and most people dissatisfied with the health care reforms. If we just tried things out at the local level that were successful and then scaled them up, I think we would have a much better chance for success. And that's exactly what's happened in the criminal justice area. I know most people think about Texas as a state that's tough on crime, and that's true. But back in the middle of the first decade of this millennium, we saw the need to deal with overcrowding, we saw high recidivism or repeat offenders, and we were facing a major budget shortfall. In other words, we tried to keep building prisons to build our way out of the problem. But instead of just spending more money to build more prisons and hoping the problems would go away, and the major problem is, that we overlooked before, which we finally realized, is that people in prison will mostly get out of prison at some point. And the question is, do they go back into prison after committing other crimes, or can we help those who are willing to accept the help, turn their lives around, and become productive members of society? So we opted for a different approach. We traded in our construction plans for plans to help lower-risk offenders turn their lives around and become productive members of society. That's because, as I said, most offenders will one day get out of prison. Today, Texas has improved and increased programs designed to help men and women behind bars to take responsibility for their crimes and then to prepare to reenter society as productive, law-abiding members of the community. I'm not naive enough to say this is something we're going to be able to do for 100% of the people behind bars. That's just not true. I wish the world was the kind of place where people, once they made mistakes and ended up behind bars, could transform their lives universally and then enter productive society. It's not true. But there are many who want to and who need our help and can benefit from some of these programs. This includes training that can really impact a prisoner's life. Somebody with a drug problem, somebody with a mental illness, somebody who's been drinking, exacerbating their problems, those sort of things can benefit from treatment and from rehabilitation. Those who are inadequately prepared educationally to enter the workforce, we can help them through work programs and job training. Many of these programs have allowed local communities to get involved as well by encouraging partnerships in Texas between prisons and faith-based organizations, people who believe in radical transformation of people's lives through their faith. They can focus on helping those prisoners who are willing and wanting to turn their lives around, get the training and life skills they need in order to succeed. I'll never forget my visit just a few months back to the maximum security prison in East Texas, the H.H. Caulfield unit, where I saw firsthand how important some of these types of programs are. I went to one section of the prison and was introduced to the shop instructor. And he told me some of the inmates in his shop class came to him unable to read a simple tape measure. I think it's shocking, it was to me. I think it's shocking to most people that anybody can reach adulthood unable to do something so basic as to read a tape measure, but yet that was an example of the type of people that were in that prison. What a remarkable example of how much opportunity there is to actually help through education, again, drug, alcohol treatment, mental health treatment, and to prepare people to reenter civil society. So I'm glad that Texas, in addition to our well-earned reputation for being tough on crime, is now known as being smart on crime, and a good example of what we could do nationally. And then we're not the only state. Other states have done the same thing too. But the results in Texas are remarkable. Between 2007 and 2012, our overall rate of incarceration fell by 9.4%. The crime rate dropped, and as I said, that's the gold standard. It's not the rate of incarceration, it's not how many people are in prison, it is what's happening to the crime rate. And our crime rate dropped. And, not insignificantly, we saved more than $2 billion worth of taxpayer money. And we were able to physically close three prison facilities, the first time that's ever happened in our state. But as I said, we're not the only ones. Georgia, for example, reduced its crime rate by more than 10% with similar programs. South Carolina and Ohio reduced theirs by 14%. This is their crime rate. And North Carolina and Texas have both reduced our crime rates by more than 20%. These reforms make our communities safer, which again is the first objective of criminal justice reform. It is the second objective of criminal justice reform, and it is the third objective of criminal justice reform. Does it make our community safer? And the answer from the evidence is yes. So I think there's just no question but that we should consider some of these reforms at the federal level. Let's take state successes and scale them up so the rest of the country can benefit where they're not otherwise already doing this, and where we can do this in the federal prison system and not just in the state system. That's where the Sentencing Reform and Corrections Act comes in. This bill includes legislation that I introduced last year that takes this Texas model and builds on it to help restore an important part of our criminal justice system that is too often forgotten, and that is rehabilitation. You know, when I went to law school more years ago than I'd like to admit, we were told that the purpose of criminal law was punishment, was deterrence, to deter others from committing similar acts, and the third, we were told that it was rehabilitation. We were going to help people change their lives if they made a mistake. But instead, over time, our prisons have become warehouses where we just warehouse people and don't do enough to try to rehabilitate those who are willing to take the opportunity to deal with their problems in a constructive sort of way and turn their lives around. So the legislation that I introduced along with Sheldon Whitehouse from Rhode Island, now Senator Whitehouse, as anybody who follows the Senate knows, we agree on very little. But we agree on this. We were both former attorney generals. He was former U.S. attorney. And he's seen a similar experience in his state. So we introduced this portion of the legislation to encourage programs that would help inmates learn valuable skills they can transfer back home to their communities and help them turn from a life of crime. And it's important to note that not only does reduced recidivism impact an individual life, which is reason enough to do what we can to help, but it also helps that individual's family, because the collateral damage from somebody making a mistake and ending up in prison, it does not stop with them. It stops with their families, including their children and their whole community. But as I said, it also makes financial sense too. The Justice Department spends around 30% of its budget detaining federal inmates. By reinvesting more of this money in recidivism reduction programs instead of building more federal prisons, we have an opportunity to save tax dollars and plow more of the money back where it can have the best impact. Inmates can be rehabilitated, neighborhoods can be made safer, and tax dollars can be better put to use. We've also made other changes in the legislation that represent the give and take that usually happens when in the Senate. Legislating is a consensus-building process, and that's a good thing. Initially, when the Corrections Act was introduced, there was a separate piece of legislation called the Smarter Sentencing Act, which focused on, as the name would suggest, sentencing, with a goal to reduce some of the mandatory minimum sentences, which were part of the 1990s effort to get tougher on crime. And this is where we've actually benefited a lot from the input from those who initially were unpersuaded about the merits of that part of the legislation. For example, we have categorically taken out, removed, any benefit of the Smarter Sentencing Act provisions for somebody who's committed a serious crime as defined by federal law. So somebody who's a violent offender, somebody who's committed a serious crime, cannot benefit from the Smarter Sentencing Act. We also, and this is an area where I'm afraid there's some misunderstanding by some folks, and there are some people actively spreading disinformation, suggesting that as a result of the Smarter Sentencing Act provisions, that it's a get-out-of-jail-free card, that we're automatically going to come in and cut prison sentences and people get out and get out on the street. That's just not true. They need to take another look at the legislation. Under some circumstances, and only if you are a low-level nonviolent offender, can you ask the court that actually in which you were convicted, and before the judge who actually dispensed the sentence, and before the prosecutor who actually put you in prison, you can ask for a reduction retroactively of long-term mandatory minimum sentences. For example, under some circumstances, somebody who's gotten a life sentence back in the days of three strikes and you're out, you could get a life sentence for three relatively minor offenses. Now, where appropriate, the judge could say, well, we're going to reduce that to 25 years. That's still a long, long time, particularly if you're talking about three relatively minor offenses. And there's one other example where a 20-year mandatory minimum sentence could be reduced to 15 years. So if you haven't served 15 years, you're certainly not going to get out of prison. But the whole point is this was a negotiated piece of legislation to try to garner as much support as we could, and I'm pleased to say today we announced five new co-sponsors of this legislation. Now I believe there are 37 senators on a bipartisan basis who support this legislation as co-sponsors. Earlier this week, we also had a very important endorsement from an organization for which I have tremendous respect. This is the largest organization of prosecutors in America. It's the National District Attorneys Association that represents about 1,500 district attorneys and 30,000 assistant district attorneys across the country. They've endorsed this legislation. And yesterday, at the Republican lunch and conference, we had people like former Attorney General Michael Mukasey, who served 20 years on the federal bench in New York, talk about how he thought this was a well-balanced and worthwhile piece of legislation. The bottom line is we need to make sure that violent offenders and hardened criminals stay in prison and away from our communities. I'm talking about people who will not take advantage of the opportunity to turn their lives around, but people who must be separated from society because they've made a decision to pursue a life of crime. But at the same time, while we focused on the hardened criminals and the most violent, we've got to address our expanding prison system that too often perpetuates a life of crime. When I was a younger lawyer, I was told that often our prison system is a organization of higher education in crime, because, of course, that's who's there, people who've committed crimes and people who've committed rather low-level, nonviolent offenses, particularly when they are housed with people who have chosen a more violent and life of crime, it can have a terrible, detrimental impact. So the idea is let's focus on the hardened criminals, the violent criminals, and let's take the low-level, nonviolent offenders and see if some of them will take advantage of the opportunity to turn their lives around. Local communities in conservative states, red states, like Texas, Georgia, North Carolina, have already proven that it's possible to do both. And after months of discussion, I'm confident we can bring this success to the rest of the country with this legislation. Like every piece of legislation, though, we know that there's an arduous path forward. While this bill was voted out of the Senate Judiciary Committee, it still needs to come to the floor of the Senate, where all 100 senators will have an opportunity to help improve that product. And then there's the House of Representatives. Earlier today, Senator Grassley, the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, and I met with Congressman Bob Goodlatte, chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, about our ideas together, how we can move this legislation forward. And I know the president is anxious to sign a criminal justice reform bill. This could actually be a good bipartisan accomplishment of the 114th Congress. So I appreciate the bipartisan effort on all sides to work constructively toward a bill that can win broad bipartisan support. If there are those who don't like parts of the bill, bring your ideas to us. That's the way this process is supposed to work. Let's make it better. Let's build bipartisan support and consensus. But let me just say in closing, I particularly want to thank the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, Chairman Grassley, for stewarding this legislation through the process. As an experienced member of the Senate, somebody who's been at this a while, he knows better than most how to shepherd legislation, particularly potentially controversial legislation, through this process, and he's been masterful in bringing us this far. But I think we owe it to our constituents and to the country to take the lessons we've learned at the state and local level, and let's bring them to benefit the rest of the country. And let's make our criminal justice system, as the name suggests, more just, and at the same time, more effective. And let's save taxpayers a buck or two in the process.